Stillness. Don't fight against the wave of the season. Look, you can't plant in the middle of a snowstorm. Okay? So you need to know the seasons. The Word of God says that the men of Issachar knew the time and seasons. It's given to you. Man of Issachar, you will know the time and seasons, and you will know what's coming up, and it won't take you by surprise, and you will be prepared, and you will too. Get ready, okay?
Traveling and his family, been in his house. He came to my house, he knew my family. The first time I was in his house, our youngest daughter was about three. So there's a connection, strong connection, and I know they carry something from the Lord that they impart everywhere they go. And I believe the Lord will give us some stuff that we carry where we want to impart to you. So it's not necessarily teaching, it's more impartation that we want to do today. So one thing is Hebrews 12:15, something the Lord speak to me. See, it came to me in a strange way because it said this, make sure that nobody is deprived from the grace of God. Okay? And I was sleeping and I woke up and I said to my wife, make sure that nobody is deprived from the judgment of God. And she's like, what? And she said, this is not the way it's written. And I said, yeah, it's make sure that nobody is deprived from the grace of God.
Amen.
Okay, so there's something where often we almost make sure that people feel like the Lord is about to judge them. And the truth is, the Lord wants to extend His grace to everybody. And He said, if they sin much, give them even more grace. So if you have a bigger sinner than you around, you should be jealous because he's going to get more grace than you. So why am I saying that? I think there's a wave of the Lord reaching out in grace to people. And for too long, the church has been more judgmental than graceful. And I think we need to apply the scripture and the plumb line. The Lord said, make sure that nobody is depraved from the grace of God. He said, nobody mean everybody. So everybody around you, even the worst person, you should make sure that they have a connection or they've been encounter with the grace of God. And so be very slow to bring them under judgment, because this is not what the Lord wants. He wants us to just be out there and be spreading the grace. And if where there's more sin, even more grace. So Lord, make us a sower. Let us sow the grace of God in everybody around us, especially those that are bigger sinners. Lord, I just want to ask you to forgive us because we have been so quick to bring judgment or declare judgment on people where your heart was for us to bring grace to them. In the name of Jesus, I pray.
Participated in a prophetic fulfillment. You know, we couldn't call it a conference because it was actually a fulfillment, I think, of Zechariah 4:10 when he talked about the plumb line. He said, I rejoice when you see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hand. And I think the plumb line went into Zerubbabel's hand. I need to explain it a little bit. This was actually instigated or started by indigenous First Nations people from around the world. So we had people who were from most of the islands in the Pacific. We had Samoans and New Caledonians. We had Solomon, New Zealand, Australia, New Guinea, Papua New Guinea. We had people from China and Mongolia. was sharing with us the word he had about alignment, because that was what was happening in Israel. In fact, the last night, there's a gentleman, Asher, one of the messianic pastors in the land, who's written a book, and on the front of the book is a plumb line, and the book is called Alignment. And so, you know, it's interesting when you travel, God speaks expressively, which means that when you travel, you see that the Spirit of God's normally speaking all over the world the same message. And so you discover that out. And so the alignment in Israel was, you know, the gospel as it started was to the Jew first, then to the Gentile. And it started with Jewish believers in Jerusalem. And these believers, the disciples, and the believers in Yeshua, were commanded first Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the othermost parts of the earth. The thing that happened at this, we were meeting in a place called Avagosh, which is an Old Testament Greek, Arium, which is where the Ark of the Covenant was 20 years. If you know the story, they were bringing the Ark of the Covenant back from captivity of the Philistines. And as they were traveling, they were carrying it in the wrong way. They had it on a cart.
Yes.
And so, and this is alignment again. They, you know, they were carrying on the cart, and the cart began to go over, and Uzzah, of course, tried to stop it, you know, falling, which I think any of us would have done. You know, it's like, this is the holy ark of the Lord. But the Lord struck him dead. I have to say this, that this is one of the things that we experienced there, is the Lord actually struck a man dead, literally, while we were there. He was from New Caledonia. They were coming in procession. There were 89 of them. And it was some of the highest worship that we were in. And they were up front, and we were up front in front. And the man dropped over dead. And we had asked for a sign. Let me tell you what happened. The fear of the Lord came into place. Just like it would have with Ananias and Sapphira or others that you hear about, or Uzzah, which we were in the place where the ark was kept. And the last day, they were taking the meeting from where we were meeting in a sports arena. There were more than 1,000 people that had come from around the world. And they were moving the meeting into Jerusalem with the concept of taking the glory of God into Jerusalem. And they were meeting in Jerusalem. So, but one of the things that happened in the alignment was as they came back with the same message. And the message is to their elder brother, Israel. And the one thing that the understanding came is that this is the first time that the messianic believers in Israel are in the land again since the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, after the book of Acts in 70 AD, the Romans dispersed the Jews out of the land. And there were no messianic community in the land until now. And let me say this, the messianic community, we call them messianic Jewish believers, are not only thriving, they're growing amazingly.
Emerging.
In fact, part of this actually goes to a round table that Sylvain and years ago in Avagosh. And the Lord had give the word that the Messianics were going to emerge from a tunnel and emerge into a position of prominence in the land. But what this honoring was, I might be taking a little time, but I feel but it was how they honored it, and how these, from the far ends of the earth, the outermost parts of the earth, they were coming back and they were saying, we got the message you sent us. The gospel came to us, and we believe. And now we're returning it back to you, our elder brother.
Full circle.
We're returning, actually from Hawaii. They actually brought a copy of the very first Bible that came to Hawaii. And the Hawaiian group there, they were saying that they had a prophecy in their land that the true God would be revealed by a man bringing a black box. And this man came carrying a Geneva Bible, an old black Geneva Bible. And they saw that as the black box. And so they converted because they had this old prophecy. And so they returned the Geneva Bible. That was a copy, not the original. But it was a copy of the one that was brought in 1820 to them. And they returned it and said, "We're returning the word to you. We've received it. Your message has come through." The thing that they did in honoring, though, was getting permission to actually speak, like as Steve did earlier. That was, you know, it was amazing, because as an elder brother, in most cultures, the elder brother is the real heir. And of course we know the elder brother is Yeshua, or Jesus is the elder brother. And so they would honor and they would say, "You have to invite us." In fact, as they were preparing for this, they asked the Messianics to kind of host it. And this is unusual in Israel. This is a first, a very first. There are a lot of...
never been done before. All the conferences in Israel are Christians coming in from places around the world, and they have their conference. And sometimes they invite the believers in the land, but sometimes they don't either. And so the believers in the land, you know, the Messianic, have never been invited to even speak one time at a conference.
Yeah, relegated to very minimal roles, if invited at all. And Avi, our friend in Israel, he's our Messianic pastor friend, he said to them, they were asking him to actually really lead this up. And he said, "What if we say no?" And they said, "We won't come." And it was really a challenge for the Messianic pastors in the land, because they had never done anything like this. It took them months to even decide to do it. They met in prayer and just seeking the Lord. And these peoples, First Nations, there was even First Nations people from America, from the different tribes that we had there. They brought gifts, and they just bestowed immense amount of gifts upon the Israeli pastors. The Israeli pastors got immensely healed from the rejection. They have suffered so much rejection, and there was such a healing there. But the alignment came, because that's how the alignment has to be. You know, when we talk about the plumb line being in the hands of Zerubbabel, that's Yeshua, that's Jesus. Because in that same chapter, it says he laid the foundations, he'll finish the work, the building. And Jesus is the foundation of who we are. And then the line goes through Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth. And all these people from afar, and there's words about islands, and they had a scripture, Isaiah 42, 10 through 13, which were the days, the 10th, the 11th, the 12th, and the 13th, that we were actually there. And so this alignment, the whole thing was the aligning, and even the fear of the Lord. Since this is the first time that the Jewish believers were put in place as the elder brother, who received the gospel first. And the first time that we had both Israeli and Gentile believers, and this was supernatural, that we, what the word of the Lord was, we have now re-entered the book of Acts. Because that's how it was in the book of Acts. There was the Jewish believers, and then the gospel went out. And for the first time now, the Jewish believers were put in their place and honored by their Gentile brothers as the older brother. And that alignment took place, and we have re-entered the book of Acts. In fact, the sign of this man dropping dead to us was a sign, because we had asked for a sign that, you know, to really confirm what we were experiencing. And it was because that's what happened in the book of Acts. We talk about the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord is going to come like you've never seen it before. The glory of the Lord is coming like we've In fact, the theme was, welcome the King of Glory. Open up all ye gates that the King of Glory may come in. And so the glory of the Lord is coming in her. And so we've entered into the book of Acts where we're going to see, again, the miracles. You know, we're going to see the miracles and even greater works. The greater works are not going to be start to be manifested in the earth. This has happened. This was a prophetic. I felt like Simeon in the temple. He waited all these years because he had a promise from the Lord that he would see Christ before he died. He would see Yeshua before he died. We have been waiting for this moment. The church has been waiting, looking for this moment. Let me tell you, it has happened. We are now back in the book of Acts. And now we're going to begin to see the things as the fulfillment and as Christ finishes the work that he began.
Who here is interested in to enter into the book of Acts? Okay. This is important. The book of Acts start with this is what Jesus have started to do and to teach. So do first and teach after. You know, when you perform miracles, it's pretty easy to teach after that. You know, so we need to go back to that. And I'm going to ask Fred, if you agree, that to pray for us for the impartation of this, returning to the book of Acts. And us, I don't want to be a spectator of that. I want to be part of the
Amen.
Book.
Amen.
So you want to pray for us?
Of the Holy Ghost. Shokara Rashambarobahi.